Hi, I'm Casey, and I'm a professor in the Information Science Department. I make videos about academic life and advice for graduate students and other academics. And I've had some requests recently to make a video about how to review a paper, which I actually think is a great topic, though as I was thinking about it, I realized that in order to think about how to review a paper mechanically, it's also important that you know how the peer review process works. It might seem like it's obvious, but when I was a graduate student, parts of it were still pretty opaque to me. The first time that I was on a program committee reviewing papers as a faculty member, it really opened up my eyes. It was like seeing how the sausage was made, which sometimes makes you want to not eat sausage anymore. Also, in addition to being a good paper reviewer, understanding how the process works has a couple of benefits in writing papers. One is that you can think about how your paper might be received during the review process. The other is that honestly, once you understand the degree of randomness that is involved in the peer review process, you actually don't feel as bad when your papers get rejected. So let's talk about how the process works and where that randomness comes from. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about both the traditional journal peer review process and in computer science specifically, our major publication venue is actually conference proceedings. And the conference peer review process with program committees is a little bit different. So I'm going to talk about both of them as we go through this. I'm not going to talk about law reviews, which is like a whole other bizarre thing that should be the topic of perhaps a whole other video. Also, I am talking here about real good academic publication venues, not predatory journals. If you want to know how peer review happens for a predatory journal, and also what I'm talking about here is of course most common in my experience. I do a lot of reviewing both for these computer science conferences as well as for a lot of journals in different disciplines. I also was the associate editor of a law-related journal for a long time, and so I have a little bit of experience from that end as well. But of course, lots of disciplines are different, lots of journals are different, and there are lots of variations on what I'm talking about, so it may not be exactly like this for the publication venue that you are thinking about. All right, so the first thing that happens here is someone writes a paper. And as you know, that is a lot of work. And even after you've written the paper, you then have to decide where you're going to submit it. Are there any deadlines? You probably have to change some kind of formatting, which ends up being a total pain. And then you fill out a form that's confusing and you submit your paper and then you wait. But what is happening while you're waiting? After it gets to the venue, there is intake of some kind. Sometimes there's an admin who is checking for desk rejects because it's too long or you did the formatting wrong or something egregious. But at some point at a journal, your paper goes to an associate editor or someone like that. And essentially, it's someone who is overseeing the review process. How they are assigned varies widely from journal to journal, as far as I can tell. Sometimes it's based on subject matter expertise, sometimes it's random or whoever happens to be doing all the papers that week. In the case when I was the associate editor for a journal, I was the only one. But in any case, at a journal, once it goes to that person, their job is to find reviewers. How many? Well, that varies. I would say that for me in the journal that I was working with, I would typically send out invitations to 4 people, hoping to get 3, and sometimes would settle for 2. But it really varies from journal to journal. It is very rare, though, for there only to be 1 reviewer for a paper. Also, as I mentioned, in computer science, where our main publication venues are conference proceedings, there is an entire committee called the Program Committee who review all of the papers at once. Those of you who are not in this field, you're going to think this is really weird. My understanding is that this is pretty unique to computer science, but might also happen in some adjacent fields, like maybe certain disciplines of engineering. I'll also link below to some resources about sort of why this is, because that's a whole other video. But in that case, there's usually two or three people who are the papers chairs of the conference who are kind of like editors-in-chief of a journal, and then a large number of associate chairs who make up the program committee. And of course, how many there are depends on the size of the conference. But these people are essentially playing the role of associate editor as if they were in a journal. Sometimes all of the reviewing happens within the program committee. So a certain number of associate chairs are assigned to each paper, and maybe one person is designated the sort of overseer meta reviewer for that paper. Or each paper is assigned to someone who finds external reviewers. Conferences that I am most familiar with, typically two associate chairs are assigned to each paper, with one of them being the meta reviewer. So it means that it's their job to find reviewers and to synthesize the reviews, and the other person who is on the paper is just serving as a normal reviewer. And it works that way in part so that when discussions of the paper happen, there are two people on the committee who have read the paper. Another thing that can happen at this point is that sometimes papers are desk rejected by the associate editor. Typically, you need to skim a paper anyway to be able to find reviewers. And so if that paper really, really misses the mark for whatever reason, and it feels like it would be a waste of time to send it out to reviewers, like it's really just gonna get rejected, it's actually a kindness to desk reject, because then the person who submitted it gets the feedback sooner and they can send it to a different venue or make revisions. Sometimes this happens when the paper is just completely inappropriate for the venue. But in any case, that next step in both of these situations is to find external reviewers. Now, how does the associate editor or associate chair who is assigned to that paper pick people to review the paper? So there are a lot of different answers to this question, and there might be sort of guidelines or suggestions for individual venues, but typically it's either something like they ask people that they know who do work in that area. They look at the citations in the paper for other papers that are similar and then find the people who wrote them. They might just do a Google Scholar search to find people. Sometimes for journals, there is a sort of slate of people who've reviewed in the past that might be organized in some way, maybe tagged by topic. Sometimes people use some big databases that people can kind of sign up for when they do reviews. For conferences, because reviews happen all at the same time, it's common for people to volunteer to review a certain number of papers, and they appear in some kind of database, sometimes tagged by expertise or something like that, where people can find them in that database to ask them to review. So here's a really important thing. People who are asked to review papers say no a lot, which is completely understandable because paper reviewing is kind of unpaid volunteer work. I guess you could argue that if you're a professor, then it constitutes academic service, which in theory is part of your job, which you are getting a salary for. However, we all know that we spend way more time on service than the 20% of our work that it's supposed to be. And if you're really having trouble finding reviewers, you might have to keep going sort of farther and farther away from what you would consider the appropriate or ideal expertise for people to review that paper. That's just how it goes. Also, if you are asked to review a paper and you can't because of timing or whatever, the kindest thing that you can do is to suggest someone else. Okay. So once you've managed to find reviewers and they have said yes, celebrate if you're that associate editor or associate chair, and then you wait for the reviews to come back. Meanwhile, the reviewer is doing their reviewing thing. And again, that's the topic of another video. Typically, as part of this process, the reviewer makes their individual recommendation should the paper be accepted or rejected, or things in between, major revision, minor revision, whatever that venue has for the options for a decision for that paper. Once all of the reviews come back, what happens next? So the associate editor or the associate chair's job is to synthesize the reviews and make a final decision or recommendation. If there's a lot of variability in the reviews, this task sucks. If you have three reviewers and one loves it and one hates it and one is meh, what do you do? This does become a little bit easier when there is an option for the paper to be revised. Because sometimes the person who hated it, if the paper is revised, they will not hate it as much. And so that's also the associate editor's job, is to look at that bad review and determine whether the things in it are things that can be fixed. Now, for some venues, and I'm thinking in particular of some computer science conferences, there is no revision. It's either accept or reject. I personally am not a fan of this model. However, that again is the topic of another video. Very often for journals, the associate editor makes a recommendation to the editor-in-chief of the journal, who then makes a decision. But in any case, this might look slightly different depending on different venues. All right, so then that editor-in-chief will send a decision to the author. But for conferences, there gets to be a super fun meeting where everyone sits around and discusses papers. Often there is a numerical or some kind of cutoff for papers that are definitely accepted or definitely rejected, and then the discussion is for the things in the squishy middle. These used to be in person, and they're actually kind of fun. Now they're mostly virtual, which in the end is good. It's more accessible, more sustainable, etc. But yeah, sometimes I'm spending like literally 3 days on video conference all day doing this. Actually, I guess we're all spending all our time on video conference these days. Yeah, this is rough. I will say one of these sort of here's how the sausage is made things that I realized about program committee meetings for conferences, it really shows how much power the associate chairs have over the fate of a paper, in part because they're the only ones in the room to explain the paper to everyone else. But really, in both cases, journals, conferences, any peer review, there's someone who's making a final decision, and that person, they have a vote that carries a lot more weight than the individual external reviewers. But that's not the only reason they have power, because remember, they're also the ones who are picking the reviewers. Choosing who the external reviewers are has a huge amount of power over the fate of that paper. This is what I mean by the randomness in the review process. Who does your paper happen to get assigned to shepherd it through the process, and who do they happen to pick for external reviewers? Sometimes you get unlucky, but then at some point, a decision is sent to the author. If it's a reject, move on. Look at the reviews, decide whether you agree with them, make revisions for things you think will make the paper better. Don't make revisions for things you don't make the paper better, because those reviewers are likely not going to see it again. Now, that said, that is not always the case, especially if you are in a small field. The same person being asked to review your paper after you submit it to a different venue could totally happen. This actually happened to me very recently. I was like, I've seen this before. But that said, you shouldn't change your paper in a way that you think will make it worse just to make a reviewer happy, especially if you don't even know for sure that that reviewer is ever going to see the paper again. If the decision is that you need to revise the paper and submit it again, you will be getting the same reviewers, hopefully. Pay close attention to what the meta review or the associate editor's comments are telling you to do. They sometimes will give you kind of hints as about which reviewers you should pay attention to. And again, they're the ones with most of the power. So if they tell you to do something, you should probably do it. And on that note, if you review a paper and then are asked to review a revision, do it. Unless there's some really good reason why you can't, you're kind of a jerk if you do not agree to review the revision. Because if a new reviewer has to come in, it's really kind of unfair to the author, because they're gonna have a whole new set of issues with the paper that they weren't told to revise the first time around. And when that happens, it's really unfortunate, though sometimes it just can't be avoided. And then after that, it all starts again, and eventually you will get a final decision whether it's good or bad. So, I don't know if you learned anything new about this process, but let's talk a little bit about how much we can trust it. I could possibly make a whole video about ways that I think the peer review system are broken. For right now, I will link to a Twitter thread about that down below. But in any case, this is what we have, and it does work generally. But there are some things that are important to understand. And one is that you may or may not be getting real experts reviewing your paper. And even when you do, you often don't have experts on every aspect of the paper. One of the things this means is that published papers will absolutely have mistakes sometimes. Perhaps because the reviewers didn't know it was a mistake, but also because there's only so much labor these reviewers can give. For example, they're not going to be pulling the things that you cite to make sure that you are representing their findings correctly, unless it's a law review, and again, that's a whole other thing. But also, it's not like the reviewers are going to rerun your statistics or redo your experiment or something that can actually check if your data is analyzed correctly. A number of years ago, there was this huge scandal about a political science graduate student who fabricated data for a really important paper. I will link to a story about that down below. It is bananas. But it got a lot of criticism for like, oh, the peer review process is broken. They should have caught this. But in some ways, the amount of work that would have had to be done to catch that problem is really more than we can expect for unpaid labor. And another thing is that a lot of the integrity of this process relies on the individual integrity of the people who are involved in it. For example, conflicts of interest essentially rely on the honor system. And you can't expect the associate editor to do deep research on the authors of every paper to find out who their co-authors are so that they aren't asked to review one of their papers. Sometimes the process is single-blinded, which means that the reviewers know who the authors are, even though the authors will not know who the reviewers are. Sometimes it's double-blinded, which means that the reviewers don't know who the authors are either. But if you know who the authors are and you're like, oh, that's my best friend, I am definitely going to give this a good review, that is unethical. But unfortunately, it sometimes depends on the honor system. And really, there's a lot of places where we just have to rely on there not being bad behavior. Bad things you could do? Apparently there are some people who collaborated to like create this group of people who were all going to give good reviews to each other's papers. Obviously deeply unethical. Or what if as a reviewer you tank a paper because their work is so close to yours that you think you're going to get scooped? Unethical. So I hope that demystified the process a little bit if you didn't really know all of the ins and outs of peer review. Again, this can be really different for different journals and in different disciplines, and so you might want to find out from someone who knows more than you exactly what it looks like for your discipline. Maybe this sparked questions for you. What questions do you have about peer review? Put them in the comments down below and I will answer if I can. And if your question is, how do I do it? How do I review a paper? Stay tuned. Maybe hit the subscribe button, and I'm hoping to do that soon. And since we're talking about peer review, a final reminder, your papers will get rejected sometimes. This is just the way of the world, so you should see the peer review process as an opportunity to improve your work. I know it's really hard sometimes, and for all the reasons I just said, reviewers sometimes get it wrong. So that means that you should feel good about your work and submitting it somewhere else where you'll get a new set of reviewers and will have a new opportunity for that randomness to work in your favor. Keep your chin up and revise and resubmit. All right, this is all I have for you right now, though. I plan to continue doing some videos about the peer review process as well as paper writing and all other kinds of things that graduate students and academics might want some advice about. I'm Casey. Thanks for watching.